Resurrection Sunday. Would you stand with us, please? We're going to worship the Lord in song now. We want you to join in with us. Every voice singing praise to the Lord, sing with us. You ready?
Oh, in the great delay, Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus, my Lord, up from the grave He arose, with a mighty triumph for His foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and He lives forever with His saints to reign. He arose.
Of Calvary was such an important place. This song calls it the mercy tree. Let's sing together.
On a hill called Calvary, there stands an endless mercy tree. Every broken, weary soul, find your rest and be made whole. Stripes of blood to wash away our shame. From the scars your love released, salvation by the mercy tree.
He was suspended there for you and me to see that
now. In the sky between two thieves, hung the blameless Prince of Peace, bruised and battered, scarred and scorned, sacred head pierced by our thorns.
we'll see. Sing this verse.
One day soon we'll see his face, and every tear he'll wipe away. No more pain or suffering. Oh, praise him for the mercy tree. Death has died, love has won. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus Christ has overcome. He has risen from the dead. Death has died, love has won. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus Christ has overcome. He has risen from the dead. Jesus Christ has overcome. He has risen from the dead. He has risen from the dead. He has risen from the dead.
That's awesome. Death has died and love has won. That's what today is all about. Happy Easter today. We're so glad to have each and every one of you here as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. And in him, we can have life, we can have hope, and we can have victory over death, hell, and the grave. And so we're so thankful to have everyone here today. But we want to extend a special welcome to those who may be visiting with us for the first time. And if that's you, welcome and thanks for being with us today. On your way out, we've got some visitor tables, some guest tables set up. And we love to connect with you as you connect with us. We have a gift for you there on the handout that you received on your way in. There's a card. If you would just take that card, let us know. We'd love to hear how you heard about Lancaster Baptist Church. And then drop that off on your way out. We've got a devotional. We've got some other resources for you. But we really just love the opportunity to meet you after the service today. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask him to bless this time together. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the truths we sang to you just a moment ago. We thank you that in your Son, Jesus, we do have victory and we do have hope and purpose. And Lord, I pray today that if there's someone that doesn't know you personally, that they would enter that saving knowledge through your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you'd be blessed by every aspect of this service. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated.
Giver of life, our Maker,
Sing, my soul, sing out and bless the Lord, for He has overcome. Oh, by His precious blood, now He's lifted high. Come, let us lift our eyes, set them on Jesus Christ. He is our risen Savior.
Behold the Lamb of God,
who heals our wounds, who knows our pain. Is His name. Nothing can ever take His place. Sing, my soul, sing out and bless the Lord, for He has overcome. Oh, by His precious blood, He's lifted high. Come, let us lift our eyes, set them on Jesus Christ. He is our risen Savior. Let the earth be filled with glory. Let our hearts be filled with praise. You are worthy, Jesus Christ. He is our risen Savior. Let the earth be filled with glory. Let our hearts be filled with praise. You are worthy, God Almighty, holy, holy, holy. Let the earth be filled with glory. Let our hearts be filled with praise. You are worthy, God Almighty, holy, holy, holy. Let the earth be filled with glory. Let our hearts be filled with praise. You are worthy, God Almighty, holy, holy, holy. Sing, my soul, sing out and bless the Lord, for He has overcome. Oh, by His precious blood, now He's lifted high. Come, let us lift our eyes, set them on Jesus Christ. He is our risen Savior.
Even if I face death, I would never deny him. At least, that's what I said. And it's what I believe. I had spent the last 3 years following him. Peter, he said, follow me, and I will make you become a fisher of men. When he fed that multitude with 5 loaves and 2 small fishes, I was there. When he raised Lazarus from the grave, I was there. When we had a Passover meal and he washed our feet, I was there too.
I was used to having answers. I was a Pharisee, a member of the ruling Sanhedrin. All of my adult life, as I passed through the streets, people clamored for my attention. Rabbi Nicodemus, teacher, tell us, what does this passage mean? How is this law applied? What is your interpretation of this verse? This was my life. It was wrapped up in the Torah and in my role as a spiritual leader. But all of this began to crumble when I met him. I saw him do things that defied explanation. He healed lepers. He gave sight to the blind. And his teaching, he spoke with an authority and understanding greater than anything I have ever heard before. How was this possible? Who was this radical from Nazareth? For the first time in my life, I felt uncertainty creeping into my mind. I was supposed to be the man with answers. But now, it seemed I had nothing but questions. I had to meet with him. I had to talk to him for myself. But I could not see him publicly, not in front of the others. So I came to him under the cover of night.
I was completely out of control, out of my mind, guilty and hopeless, oppressed and controlled by demons and dark spirits. I was just Mary Magdalene, a woman in desperate need of salvation. So many in our town, so many in our own family, forsook and neglected me. People went out of their way to avoid being near me, but not him. When I was desperate, hopeless, lost, and alone, he came to me. He not only healed me, he saw me. He accepted me. He rescued me.
I came to him by night, and he did meet with me. I wanted to quiz him about his approach to the Torah, about his background and schooling. But he turned straight to me. With both compassion and authority, he told me that I must be born again. I will never forget as he looked into my eyes and said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." The words he spoke were different than the rules and religion I had been trusting in. And I was sure there was something genuine and holy about this man.
No silver or gold could weigh on the scale. treasure of mine, could pay to the debt of mercy. The things of earth will surely fade away. One pardon will prevail. Jesus' blood has ransomed me, has raised me up and washed me clean. Oh, the cross of Christ has the victory. Jesus' blood has set me free. No prison of shame can rise up against His power. When He says I'm free and I'm free forever. The things I've done are gone.
Redeemed and I'm forgiven. Oh, thank you for the cross. I am now a new creation, white as snow, completely blameless. I will worship in your presence. Oh, thank you for the cross. There is now no condemnation, no divide or separation. I'm redeemed.
Popular, too unconventional, too, well, everything. That was the determination of my colleagues. Jesus was making himself out to be our Messiah, and they determined that he had to be stopped. I tried to give perspective and be a voice of reason, but the truth was, they hated him. There had been times in the past that I had questioned our court's judgments, but I never thought I would see the day that Caiaphas, our high priest, to have an innocent man condemned to death.
I couldn't believe it. I knew we had upset the Pharisees. I knew the high priest Caiaphas opposed our ministry. But that? I was not expecting that. Jesus said we were going to rule with him in his kingdom. So when he was arrested and tried, it shook everything I had come to expect. I know that he had tried to warn me, but I never really believed it. There wasn't room in my mind to grasp it until he actually was arrested. And then at his trial, that woman outside, she asked me, "Didn't I see you with him?" I know I should have been strong, but I was so scared, I denied it. And then another one asked, and another. Three times they asked. Three different people were convinced of something I should have been proud of. That I was a disciple of Jesus. But I cursed and told them I never knew the man. And now I'm ashamed. I strayed so far.
Caiaphas and the other Pharisees had him arrested. I could not leave. I had to stay, had to watch the unimaginable, the unthinkable. They hired people literally off the street to testify against him. The Pharisees riled the crowd to cry for his crucifixion and sentenced him to death by crucifixion. Jesus did not even resist. I could see in his eyes pain, yes, but there was more. I could see compassion and forgiveness. As the soldiers nailed him to the cross, I heard him say, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." He was a man full of love.
I could no longer hide my belief. I knew it would be the end of my authority and my position inside the Sanhedrin. But what good was that now? He had opened my heart. I had watched him from a distance for years. Now, I was ready to follow him. But he was dead. Until he wasn't.
Days later, as we went to take spices to anoint his body, when we arrived at the tomb, it was empty. It was also unexpected and confusing. But I saw an angel who spoke to us and said, "He is not here, for he is risen, as he said."
At Sunday morning, when Mary came running, out of breath, she had been to the tomb and he was not there. I was convinced she had lost her mind. But John and I went to see for ourselves. We couldn't believe our eyes. We saw the empty tomb and his burial clothes folded. We knew he was alive again. Most of the others were filled with hope and excitement, but me, I knew what I had done. So I went back to my old life. I went back to fishing. I was not going to face him again. I was humiliated and filled with grief. But that did not deter him. He came to me. He asked if I loved him, and he knew that I did. With compassion and resolve, he told me that he was not through with me. I had left him, but he would never leave me. He still had a plan and purpose for my life. I had wandered from him, but he lovingly guided me back to a relationship with him.
The road to His mother went. My name is Eric, Eric Aguilar, and I actually joined Lancaster Baptist in late October. I feel like my story resonates with Peter a lot, because not only did I understand that Peter was a real true disciple for God, but he also had strayed away. And once he strayed away, he knew that he had nothing left.
My name is Friday, and my last name is Roland Arrowhorn, and I've been attending the Lancaster Baptist Church since October last year. In a lot of ways, my story is like Nicodemus in the Bible, when he went to Jesus and said, you know, how can I be born again?
My name is Mary Ledesma, and I've been at Lancaster Baptist since 2015. Before I started coming, I was a party person, a club hopper, strip clubs, dance clubs, and just had a horrible, like, just life, no peace, just depressed all the time, and I just wanted a lot of attention, so I was seeking attention in the wrong areas. What came with my party life was 5 kids, then I became a single mom, and then even more depression, because I realized that all that stuff that I got into, it didn't do anything but just make things worse. In my life, it's like Mary Magdalene. I had a lot of chaos in my life, like how she did. And just like how Jesus set her free, he also set me free.
I was very young. I was 17, hadn't even graduated high school. So I ended up straying away from God. Almost lost my mother and never grew up with dad. I became homeless. I was homeless for 2 years. And from there, I started feeling like God was against me, so I strayed away from him.
You know, I was raised in a Christian home, went to a Christian school, so I never really knew, you know, what it is to actually walk the way of Christ. I was just basically like, you know, just going to church for the name of it.
One of my friends, I met her at the gym, and, you know, she started attending the Bible college. I started asking her questions about God, and because of that, I was able to attend Lancaster Baptist, and I got saved that same day.
And I talked to my sister Jacqueline, and she said, well, I went to Lancaster Baptist, and I learned, I'm growing, the message is good. And then just the horrible situations that I was in, I was like, I'm broken, I do need Jesus, so I accept him.
One of my other family members, one time they came over to fellowship at Lancaster Baptist Church, we came over, and I was touched by the preaching that day. Brother Jerry showed up on my door. He came over, we sat in my living room, you know, so we went back and forth. Then they asked me if, you know, if I'm ready to give my life to Christ. You know, I said yes.
And now, like, you know, I feel like I have filled that void of emptiness inside of me with peace, and that comes from Jesus Christ.
Well, I don't worry about anything anymore. I used to always be stressed out, worrying about, like, bills, everything. And now I just know he's gonna work it out, so I just go day by day, just trusting the Lord. I'm a lot stronger now through those trials, and I know, like, whatever I go through, he has a purpose for it.
It took a lot of fear away from me. Christ has paid, you know, the way for us already, that as long as I receive him as my personal savior, and you know, he has always forgiven me for all I have done.
Victory.
This is all.
all relate to that, to like pain, anxieties, and overthinking and stuff. And we have one antidote, and that's Jesus Christ. And when I actually willingly, seeked him, he started unraveling, like, all the things that, I had inside. He turned my heart from stone to very tender. And now, like, it just seeing the miraculous, events that have happened in my life, like my mother, she's doing amazing. I'm doing great. And I'm a firm believer that, God has actually used my trials to really build a strong foundation.
Me and my children, we all got baptized. And, a lot has changed. And my Christian life becomes so strong now. When I meet somebody that I want to share the word of God with, I share as much as I can by telling them, the Lord is good. You're someone saying no matter what the problem is, it's gonna have your back.
I said, okay, Lord, I'm gonna wait for you. I'm gonna trust you, and if you want me to have a husband, I'll have one. And he did bless me with a husband. I'm a wonderful husband. And I started over, and we have a 4-year-old son, Nehemiah. Now, because of me being in Lancaster Baptist and growing, my life's changed, and now I can raise a son that has a dad and a mom.
This is our redemption story. This will always be our song. Jesus died and rose and will come again, once and for all. Let the whole earth shake with the sound of praise and the wonder of it all. For the King of Kings paid the debt for me.
Thank you, choir. Thank you, orchestra, for an amazing presentation of the gospel. All of these folks volunteer. They're wonderful, faithful members of Lancaster Baptist Church. Let's thank them once again for a great presentation this morning. Welcome to Lancaster Baptist. I want you to take your Bible or take your worship folder and find our text. We're going to get there in just a moment, Luke 24. I want you to find that. I heard about a man and his wife and his mother-in-law who went on a vacation to the Holy Land. And while they were there, sadly, his mother-in-law passed away. The undertaker told them, you can have her body shipped back to America for $5,500, or she can be buried right here in the Holy Land for $150. The man thought about it. He said, let's just go ahead and ship her home. The undertaker said, why would you spend $5,000 to ship your mother-in-law home when she could have a wonderful burial here for $150? The man replied and said, well, a man died here 2,000 years ago. He was buried here, and 3 days later he rose from the dead. I just can't take that chance. I want you to know Terry gave me permission to tell that joke this morning. She actually gave me that joke, so if that offended any mother-in-laws, I repent right now. I'm very, very sorry. Well, President Joe Biden declared today, Easter Sunday, Transgender Visibility Day, which is a mockery to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We stand here this morning to bring honor and glory to the name of Jesus Christ. We will not bend. We will not bow. We will not salute his flag. We will honor the Lord as King, and we will honor the Lord as our risen Savior at Lancaster Baptist Church this morning. I want you to stand together with me as we honor the Lord together and turn to Luke 24, and we're going to read in verse number 1 and read down through verse number 8.
As we read our text this morning, I hope you have a Bible or something to look to as we read together. And as we celebrate this morning the meaning of this special day, which is the resurrected Christ. Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre, and they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth. And they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. Let's say that together, verse 8. And they remembered his words. Let's try to remember some of his words this morning, and let's begin with a word of prayer. Father, thank you for the wonderful musical and presentation that we have seen. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love to us in coming to this earth, dying for our sins, and raising again on the third day. Father, speak to our hearts, meet our needs. If there are those with us today who do not have the hope of their own personal resurrection, show them how that is possible through Christ. And I pray and ask this in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Jesus had clearly taught that he would rise again. But somehow, by that resurrection morning, those were just words. Pilate had scourged the Lord Jesus Christ. He had delivered the Lord Jesus to persecution and then to crucifixion. The Lord Jesus had walked up the hill of the skull. The Roman soldiers there on that Mount Calvary placed the nails through his hands and through his feet. As he hung on the cross with the crown of thorns upon his head, the blood was flowing down. No doubt Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary Magdalene, and the others were literally in shock at what had taken place. No doubt their world had been turned upside down. And who can blame them for the fact that in the tension and during the anxiety of this moment, they perhaps forgot some of the words that Jesus had told them along the way. The Bible tells us that as they came on that first day of the week, they were coming to further prepare the body of Jesus for burial. Perhaps they would have the privilege of somehow ministering to him in this moment and somehow with these spices and with these fragrances, bringing a sense of peace even to their own life. But when they came that first resurrection morning, they were not prepared for what they were going to see. For as they approached the tomb, the stone was rolled away, the tomb was empty, it was not at all as they had expected upon their arrival. I want you to take a moment with me this morning to visit this place, to think with me about what those women saw on that first resurrection morning. And the first thing we're going to notice today is the emotion of it all. We're going to see this to be a very emotional moment for them. In fact, as they come to the empty tomb with these burial spices, the Bible tells us that the one woman that had the greater part in the role was Mary Magdalene, and Mary Magdalene had come from a place called Magdala. I've visited this village. It is there on the western shores of the Sea of Galilee, not far from Capernaum, the town where Jesus often resorted and ministered. And as they came together to this empty tomb, the Bible says, first of all, that they were perplexed. In verse number 4, we see the word, as they came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout. This means they were entirely at loss. They were completely puzzled. They did not expect to see the sight that they saw. They had not remembered what Jesus said in Matthew 12:40, where he said, For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Jesus Christ, being God in the flesh, literally prophesied his own death, burial, and resurrection. He prophesied exactly how many days he would be in the grave because he is God and knew all In John 10:17, the Bible says, "Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it up again." Who says that other than God? And he had prophesied these things to them. Yet, because they had forgotten his words, they were perplexed. And then the Bible says in verse 5, "And as they were afraid..." And who could really blame them for being afraid? The Bible says in verse 4 that while they were standing there, two men stood by them in shining garments. I mean, honestly, if you were standing out in your front yard, maybe looking up at the snow on the mountains this morning, and suddenly two men in shining white garments appear out of nowhere, how many of you might be a little afraid at that? Here they are, emotionally struck by the loss of the moment. Here they are trying to put together the pieces of the worst puzzle they could ever imagine. Suddenly, two angelic beings show up at their side. The Bible says in verse 5 they were afraid of this. And then the angels begin to question them. The angels are now talking to them. And the Bible tells us what they say in verse number 5. "And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they," the angels, "said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead?" Think of that question. Why seek ye the living among the dead? Imagine the spectrum of the emotion these women were going through, sorrow and grief and perplexity and wondering about the open tomb, the shock, the fear of it all. And no doubt it was difficult for truth to settle in. It was difficult to really reasonably stand on a foundation of hope with all that was going on in their heart. But now, as the questions come, as they're asked these questions about all that was taking place, the Bible says in verse 8, "And they remembered his words." It begins to come back to them. So many times we're like that. We hear things when we're in Sunday school as children. We hear things maybe on a television show or a radio broadcast, and there are these times when we hear the truth of the gospel, and yet we get busy with work, and we go through difficulties in life, and we have friends that pass away, and we have trials and medical situations, and just with the busyness of life, many times the truth never really sinks in. And sometimes it takes a moment for us to process the truth into our lives. Reminds me of a church that had an Easter program, and they had a little boy in the program named Billy. He was 5 years old. He had one line. His line was, "He is not here, he is risen." That was his one line. Let's say that one line together. "He is not here, he is risen." That was his line, and they practiced it and practiced it. It came time for the play, and it was almost time, and sure enough, here came his time. And suddenly, he forgot what to say. Completely forgot his line. Finally, the director went over and whispered into his ear. He got a big smile on his face. He grabbed the microphone and he said, "He is not here. He is in prison." You know, one of the scariest things a pastor can ever do is stand out at the door after church and ask people, "What was the sermon about today?" And sometimes people say, God? The Bible? You know? And so let's not be too hard on these women who forgot some of what Jesus had taught them. Emotion has a way of doing that. And I'm speaking today to people who've experienced anxiety and trauma and difficulty in their lives. And the devil likes to take all of that and push us farther from God and farther away from the words of God. But thankfully, Jesus comes back to us again and again. And that's why I want you to notice how the women move from emotion to evidence. From emotion to evidence. When we have fear and emotion, we must turn to a source of confidence. And the two angels invite these women to see the physical evidence of the fact that Jesus Christ was risen. And the first thing they're invited to see is the empty tomb. Now, amazingly, this empty tomb had been guarded by a Roman guard. Pontius Pilate had declared unto them, "Set a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can." So they went and made the sepulcher sure, and they sealed the stone, and they set a watch, which would include a number of Roman soldiers. And so it was that this watch was made, and the soldiers protected this area, and the stone was sealed so that none of the disciples of Jesus, as they thought, would perhaps come and steal the body of Jesus Christ. No one expected that there would be a stone rolled away. After all, this guard would not permit it. After all, this was a sealed tomb indeed. But the Bible says in Matthew 28:2, "And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment was white as snow. And for the fear of him, the keepers did shake." These Roman soldiers who were grizzled veterans in battle, who had no doubt seen death many different times, when they saw the angel sitting on that stone, they ran away, they vacated their post, and the tomb sat there empty. Not only do we see the evidence of an empty tomb, but we see the evidence of the grave clothes laid neatly in the tomb. The Bible tells us that these grave clothes, in verse 12, just simply laid there as they had been vacated by their occupant, the Lord Jesus Christ. Then arose Peter and ran under the sepulchre, and stooping down, he beheld the linen clothes laid by themselves, and departed wondering in himself what had come to pass. The Bible tells us the same of the napkin that was used for the burial purposes around the head of the Lord Jesus. John 20, verse 6 says, "And the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself." You see, the Lord Jesus Christ suddenly, miraculously vacated this tomb. And those garments that were kept in the burial grounds and had been wrapped around his body were left there in the tomb. And this napkin that was around his head left there neatly in the tomb. They were not stolen with his body. They were not stolen apart from his body. They were left there because God Almighty had arisen from the grave. The tomb is the evidence, and the napkin and the garments are the evidence of a vacated place, vacated by the Lord Jesus Christ 3 days later, just as he said. Now think about the miraculous ramifications of that empty tomb. Compare it to the great resting places of others throughout the world. The pyramids of Egypt are famous because they contain the mummified bodies of the pharaohs of Egypt. Westminster Abbey in London is the renowned resting place for the nobles of the British society. Muhammad's tomb in Medina, Saudi Arabia, is notated as the stone coffin holding the bones of Muhammad. The Taj Mahal was built as a memorial to the wife of one of the Shahs in India, a beautiful resting place. Arlington Cemetery in Washington, D.C. is revered as the honored resting place for many outstanding Americans. But the garden tomb of Jesus Christ is not famous because of what is inside of it. It is famous today because it is empty. And we thank God for the evidence of our Lord Jesus Christ deity. The empty tomb, the folded grave clothes, the heavenly testimony. God sent down an angel in verse number 5 to ask, "Why seek ye the living amongst the dead?" And in verse 6 to say, "He is not here, he is risen as he said." And he says in verse 6, "Remember how he spoke these things unto you." In Luke 9 and 22, saying, "The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be slain and be raised again the third day." You see, the fact of the matter is that the greatest evidence of all for the Christian faith, the greatest evidence of all for our faith this morning, is the empty tomb and the grave clothes laying in the tomb and the witness of the angels. But if you'll not believe that, then I would share with you Acts chapter 1 and verse 3, which says, "To whom he showed himself alive by many after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God." Scripture records that the resurrected Christ, no one ever makes it past crucifixion. The resurrected Christ not only was crucified, not only was laid in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, but the third day rose again, and the record records that 1,500 people saw the resurrected Christ. Ladies and gentlemen, every one of us in a court of law would be thrilled to have 1,500 witnesses testifying on our behalf. Jesus Christ is the proven, risen Savior and Son of God this morning. The bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead is the crowning proof of Christianity. Now, those women had to move past their feeling of emotion. And a lot of times when it comes to religion, people say this to me, well, I feel like I might be saved. I feel like maybe I'll go to heaven. I feel confused about all the different religions. I've had some bad experiences in my life. I think I learned about God once in the hospital. I went to church with my grandma when I was looking, and a lot of different convoluted emotions, feelings, and history can come into our lives through the course of time. But we must move from emotion to evidence. We must base our faith on the truth of the Word of God, on the revelation of God, on the witnesses of God. And so these women are moving from emotion to evidence. And finally, this morning, they move to the expectations of the gospel. Now that they understand, now that they're remembering, now that their faith is coming back, there will be some expectations in their life. Let's see where that journey of expectation begins. It begins in verse 8 with those words we read a moment ago, and they remembered his words. It is the word of God that will give you expectation. The word of men, so oftentimes, are words that are lies, are words that are deceiving, oftentimes false religion, oftentimes new religion, even as I mentioned a moment ago, sacrilegion that would take away anything from the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And we must understand today that our only hope must be founded on what the Bible says. Amen. The Word of God. And they remembered his what?
Words.
Say it with me. And they remembered his what?
Words.
His words. So then, the Bible says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. You may not like the architecture. You may not like one of the songs. You may not like my jokes. But there's one thing that none of us can argue. That is the infallible, inerrant Word of God. And the Word of God will give you a foundation for your life, for your marriage, for your child rearing. It will give you an expectation for the life after this life. Their faith was based on the Word of God. As I said, man's word is not always reliable. I heard about a letter that was written to a young man recently, and it said, "Dear Johnny, no words could express my unhappiness since I broke off our engagement. Please say you'll take me back. I love you. I love you. I love you. Love always, Jane. P.S. Congratulations on winning the lottery." Now, how many of you might be suspicious of Jane's love, right? Well, we're not talking about what men say today. We're talking about what God says. God had promised a resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15:3, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins," listen, "according to the Scriptures." The time of his death, the place of his death, the way of his death, the blood suffering of his death, all of it was prophesied hundreds of years before Jesus Christ died. It was according to the Scriptures. And the prophecy was not only a death, but the prophecy was also the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. There was a Muslim man in Africa who became a Christian, and some of his friends said, "How could you do that? How could you become a Christian?" He said, "Well, it's like this. Suppose you're going down a road and suddenly there's a fork in the road, and you look at the fork in the road and there are two men there. One is dead, one is alive. Which one would you ask to show you the way?" I suggest this morning you follow the direction of the one that is living today, and his name is Jesus Christ. God had promised a resurrection. Mary Magdalene had believed on the Lord Jesus, and now she's remembering those words. And the Bible says in John 20 and verse 15, Jesus said unto her, "Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou?" She's supposing that he was the gardener after this resurrection. She said, "Sir, if you have borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said unto her, "Mary." And she knew that voice. He said unto her, "Mary." And the Bible says she turned herself and saith unto him, "Rabboni," which is to say, "Master." It's all coming back. The emotions are settling. The word is being heard. She's understanding anew and afresh. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is alive, just as he said. I'm telling you this morning, the word of God will inspire you and encourage you and settle you so that you might follow him and live with him for all of eternity. One of you today might be like a man in the Bible named Thomas. Somebody tell me what they called him. What did they say? Doubting Thomas. And after the resurrection, he was doubting and discouraged. And he said, I'm not going to believe unless I can even touch him. When Jesus appeared to Thomas in the resurrected state, Thomas said unto him, my Lord and my God. And Jesus did not say, don't call me God. Jesus received that worship because he is fully God. The Bible says that Jesus said to Thomas, Thomas, because thou hast seen me and hast believed, thou hast believed, but blessed are those who have not seen me and have believed. Our expectation must not be based on the word of a church or a religion or even a good friend. Our expectation must be placed on the word of God. And when you place your expectation in the promises of the word of God regarding the death, burial, and resurrection, you will secondly learn that it will provide for you redemption. You see, the Bible message, the message of the cross, is a message of redemption. And we all need redemption because we have all sinned. We all fall short. I don't care what your background is. You're hearing a message from a sinner today. We all have a sinful heritage. The Bible says in Romans 5:12, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. The Bible says that because of the sin of Adam and Eve, the federal head of this human race, the first man and woman, disobeyed God, and sin came into our bloodline. The race called the human race is tainted with sin. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Listen, all the cheating, all the hurt, all the brokenness, all the wars and rumors of wars are because of the sinful line in the human race. And it is because of that sin that we all need a redeemer. We all need a covering for our sin. We all need the atonement of our sin that is found only in Jesus Christ. Even our sweet little children over in the Sunday school this morning are sinners. How many of you know that? Even those little tiny babies laying over there, I'm sorry to disappoint you, they're pulling each other's hair out right this minute probably, fighting over a toy. And no one has to teach them how to sin. They just have it in their nature, as the Bible says. One boy asked another, how did you get those bruises on your arm? He said, I ate some chocolate Easter eggs. He said, I didn't know eating chocolate Easter eggs gives you bruises on your arm. He said, they were my brother's chocolate Easter eggs. All have sinned, but Jesus died for our sin. But God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Colossians 1:14 says, our redemption is found through the blood that Jesus Christ shed on the cross. All our sinners, Christ died for our sin, and Christ came to give us peace with God. You see, that's what the blood of Christ will provide. It says he was delivered for our offenses. He was raised for our justification. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. If you want peace with God, my friend, turn to Christ today. Turn away from false religion. Turn away from false expectations. And turn to the only one that ever conquered sin, death, hell, and the grave. And he will save your soul even this morning. Amen. He will provide for you, finally, eternal life. He'll provide eternal life for those who turn exclusively to him. Eternal life is found in Jesus Christ. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. If you have a job this morning and you go work for a week or two, at the end of that week or two, you're going to get a wage. You're going to earn, hopefully, that wage. That's your deserving payment. God says the wages for sin is death, and the implications of that, separation from God, physical death, spiritual death. God says the wages of sin is death, an eternal separation from God in a Christless hell. That's what I deserve because of my sin. But, how many of you are thankful for that word? But, the Bible says, the gift of God. How many of you like the word gift? We're not telling you you've got to give money to go to heaven. We're not telling you you've got to do other stuff to go to heaven. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. How do you get that kind of a gift? Through Jesus Christ our Lord. The church cannot give you eternal life. The Pope cannot give you eternal life. The president certainly cannot give you eternal life. This church cannot give you eternal life. The baptistry water cannot give you eternal life. Only Jesus Christ can give eternal life. But you must turn to Him and seek it from Him. You must call out to Him with a heart of humility and a heart of confession. The Bible is very clear. Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life." Jesus said, "I give eternal life." He is the only one who can. And all of it is because of the resurrection. He is the only one that conquered death and the grave. 1 Peter 1:3 says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us to a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." We have hope. We have this expectation because there is an empty tomb. He was the first fruits of many who will follow after Him. And it says we have the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead to an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Think about that, an inheritance reserved in heaven. Most of us today don't have much of an inheritance anywhere. But God says, "I've got one waiting for you in heaven." I was reading this past week about Prince William and Kate, and some of you are familiar with Kate's battling with cancer, and many people are praying for her around the world. They have a little boy by the name of William. William's 11 years old. He is the second in line for the British crown. And I was reading a little bit about their family, and I read that when William ascends to the throne, he will immediately inherit $1 billion. How many of you would like to inherit $1? Right? He's going to inherit $1 billion. But you know, even the royal family is beginning to figure something out. Because great-grandmother recently went away from this earth, and I believe went to be with the Lord in heaven. Their grandfather, the king, is battling cancer now. Their dear mother, Kate, is battling cancer. They're learning what all of us learn eventually, that life is but a vapor. It really doesn't matter how much you amass in this world. It doesn't matter how many worldly inheritances you have. Jesus said, "What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul?" And my friend, you may not have much of an inheritance in this world. But if you would believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and receive Him into your heart, you could have an eternal inheritance forever and ever reserved in heaven for you, even from this day going forward, if you would believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, an incorruptible and undefiled inheritance. Now, no one can have the expectation of this inheritance. No one can have the expectation of heaven if they're worshiping a bunny rabbit or worshiping after some ideology, such as our president mentioned Friday. No one is going to find heaven if their worship is misplaced. Our worship, our faith, must be firmly resting in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says it this way, "But as many as receive Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name." That is to say, if someone rejects the name of Jesus Christ, there is no hope of eternal life in heaven. It is only to those who believe on His name. If you've never placed your faith in Jesus Christ, then whatever the case, whatever it takes, put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ today. The other day, on Tuesday, I was planning out my day, and Terry said to me, she said, "Honey, I need to go to Costco." And she said it with a very resolute tone, "I need to go to Costco." I said, "Oh, wonderful. Have a nice time." She said, sometimes stuff is really heavy over there at Costco. How many of you husbands know when your wife is kind of giving you a hint, right? And so at lunchtime, we went over to Costco, and as we were there, we were trying to walk around, and if you've been there lately, have you noticed they give away all these free treats? How many of you have noticed that? They're just every aisle, free treats, and just lines of people trying to get in and out, and there's lines of people, and those lines of people just bugged me, because I want to be in the front of the line getting the treat. I don't want to be in the back of the line getting the treat, you know? We're waiting. We get all through that. We go. We pay for all of our Easter stuff, and we're on the way out. And if you've ever been to Costco, before you can get out, you've got to show them the what? The receipt. And the receipt is proof of payment. They want to know you've paid for the goods. And I want you to understand something this morning. The cross of Jesus and the empty tomb is God's receipt to tell you, I have paid for your sin. You don't have to pay for it. You can't pay enough for it. You can't redeem yourself. You can't give yourself an inheritance. It is the gift of God to all who believe. And God says, take your sin, it's paid for. Take your shame, it's paid for. Take your past mistakes, your slavery to sin, all of it. It's paid in full by the blood of Jesus Christ. A free gift today. All you must do is turn to Christ and believe on Him for your salvation. This is His proof. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And this is the glory of resurrection. And you can have eternal life through the resurrected one, the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we praise you and thank you this morning for the wonderful, glorious gift of our salvation. Thank you that we can move past emotion. We can move into the evidence of truth. And based upon that evidence, we can have an expectation of eternal life in heaven. Please help us to ponder these truths in these next moments, Lord, I pray. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed for just a moment. With our heads bowed and eyes closed, would you just think about the message we've seen and heard today. Just think about it. I want to ask you this morning, my friend, do you know beyond the shadow of a doubt that you've received this gift of eternal life? We all know we're sinners. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Maybe you've been trusting in a church. Maybe you've been trusting in yourself. I wonder how many of you can look back in the course of your life and you can say, Pastor Chappell, there was a day when I heard the evidence. I realized I was a sinner. I realized Jesus was the perfect sacrifice. And I cried out to Jesus in prayer. Maybe you were sixth grade or maybe you were 60. I don't know. And you put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. How many this morning can say, Pastor Chappell, I remember when I put my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Sitting here now, I have the full expectation of life after this life, of an eternal inheritance. God has given this promise to me, and I have believed it. I'm saved. I'm on my way to heaven. If you know that as you sit here, if that's your expectation based on the Bible, could you lift your hand this morning as a testimony? All right, thank you. God bless you. Many did not raise your hand, and I want to thank you for not raising your hand. And if you feel comfortable, if you didn't raise your hand, I'd like you, while others have their heads bowed, I'd like you just to maybe look up here and let me visit with you for a second about this very important matter, because it is super important. Thank you. Thank you for taking a moment. I want to tell you this very, very clearly. God loves you. Jesus died for you. He died for your sin and mine. And Jesus Christ, to prove that He was God, the only one that could cover sin, He rose up again on the third day. If you are willing to come to Jesus and just to simply call out to Him in prayer, and you can do that right here and right now, and just say, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Lord Jesus, I believe that You're perfect. I know I'm not. You're the perfect Son of God. Jesus, I want to ask You to come into my life and be my Savior, then today could be the day of your salvation. All you have to do is call out to Him and ask Him to be your personal Savior. And in a moment, as we stand to sing, I'm going to invite you to join with me here, and I'm just going to help you pray a prayer of salvation so that you might know what it means to have Christ as your Savior and the expectation of heaven as your very own. It's the most important decision you'll ever make in life, and I want to invite you to make it even today. Father, you know who's in this room who needs to make this decision. I want to pray right now that everyone in this room that is not expecting heaven at this moment, that they would come this morning to trust you as their personal Savior. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand together very quietly and carefully, if I may have your attention. This is a very sacred moment in our service. In the next moment or two, this man right here is going to lead in a song. When he begins that song, listen very carefully. If you're not sure, if you don't have the expectation of heaven, I want to encourage you to do something this morning. I'm going to come stand right down here. If you'd like to know for sure that heaven is your eternal home, your sins are forgiven, and all of it based on the evidence of the Word of God, then I'm going to invite you to leave your seat and come down here and shake my hand. And after a few moments, I'm going to lead you in a prayer and help you with knowing for sure that Jesus Christ is your Savior and heaven is your home. If you've never settled this issue, maybe you've had some religion, maybe not, it doesn't matter. But if you're not 100% sure that Christ is your Savior, when the song begins, just come up here and meet me and stand with me, and I'll help you from there. As we begin right now, if God speak in your heart, if you want Christ as your personal Savior,
Lord,
you want that expectation, just step out from where you are and come here and meet me at the front. If you lifted your hand, if you did not, if you need Christ as Savior, come right up here. We'd like to talk to you this morning.
You, I fall.
Who else would like to come today and accept Christ?
You're the one that guides my heart.
What's your name? Nice to meet you. Who else needs to trust Christ as your Savior? Just come right up here. Don't be embarrassed at all. If you've never made this decision, if you don't have this expectation, God spoke to your heart, you come.
My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you.
Choir, sing another verse or two. Some of you looked right in my eyes as I spoke to you a moment ago. Come on now, step out. If God spoke to your heart, we'll wait for you this morning.
I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I'd fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart.
Anyone else want to come and trust the Lord Jesus as their Savior? The most important decision in life.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you, my one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need.
Now, let's take a minute with these here at the front, and maybe a few that didn't come down, but you know who you are, and this is a moment when you need to make a decision for Jesus. All of you right here at the front, I'm so glad that you came. Let me ask you a couple of questions. Do you believe from the Bible that you're a sinner who falls short of God's perfection? Do you understand that? Do you understand that? All right. Do you believe today that Jesus Christ was God's perfect Son when He died on that cross and He shed His blood for your sin? Do you believe He rose up again on the third day? Isn't that awesome? Then right now, I'm going to help you in a word of prayer. And I'll help you along with the words. I want you to repeat these words and mean them from your heart as we pray to the Lord Jesus. And any of you out here who need to make this decision, maybe you are a little weirded out by walking to the front, but right where you are, sir, you can pray this prayer. And if you mean it in your heart, the Lord Jesus Christ will save you in this very moment. So let's pray it together right here at the front. Just pray it out loud with me, all right? Let's have our heads bowed and let's pray with these folks. And you repeat after me here at the front, just out loud with your voices. Dear Lord,
dear Lord,
I confess that I am a sinner.
I confess that I'm a sinner.
I believe that you are the Son of God. That you shed your blood for my sin. And that you rose again on the third day. I ask you to come into my life. Cleanse my sin. And give me a home in heaven. I trust only in you. And I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible says, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Lord Jesus, that you may know that you have eternal life. And whether you prayed that here at the front or whether you prayed that out here in the audience somewhere, it's the most important decision you'll ever make in your life. Right now, some of our assistant pastors want to take you. They've got a Bible, a gift for you. They want to give you a little record of your decision. So follow some of these right here, if you would, and they'll help you out this way, and they'll give you that gift. And some of our counselors, if you prayed that prayer and still want to come and meet with these folks and make a record of your decision today, you can step out right now. And what a tremendous blessing. Let's congratulate these folks again for the decision that they made this morning. Let's be seated just for a quick moment and find out what's coming up next today and how we might serve you in the days ahead.
Every mom and every child deserve a community of prayer and support. Being a mom and raising kids in today's environment is challenging. And that is why this Mother's Day, May 12th, we will take time in our 10:45 a.m. service to recognize and honor all moms. We will have a time of prayer asking God to give us wisdom and direction as we raise our children.
Every married couple is invited to join us Saturday, April 27th, for a one-day marriage conference at the Walther Center. You and your spouse will enjoy an opening session from Pastor Chappell, and we'll have a chance to attend split sessions with topics like navigating life's challenges together and building strong foundations for children. Vision, values, and expectations for young couples, and other sessions that will strengthen your marriage. The cost is $45 per couple, and that includes lunch. On-campus child care will be provided through sixth grade for $15 per child. You can sign up at lancasterbaptist.org or the church app today.
Are you tired of feeling overwhelmed by life's challenges? Ready to step into a life of boldness and confidence? Join us for Courageous Living, a powerful sermon series with Pastor Paul Chappell, which will uncover biblical strategies for overcoming struggles with courage and conviction. Let's embrace a life of fearless living together. Join us every Sunday at Lancaster Baptist Church. Courageous living, because God made you to be more than a conqueror.
Sunday, May 5th, Lancaster Baptist Church will be hosting a special service to honor the first responders of the Antelope Valley. We love our police officers, firefighters, and medical staff, and want to take some time to appreciate all you do for our community. Join us at our 10:45 service as we thank these faithful servants.
To really experience Lancaster Baptist Church, you have to check out one of our adult connection groups. These small groups meet weekly on Sunday mornings at 9:45. These groups provide opportunities for meaningful friendships as well as valuable Bible instruction tailored for your life stage. Whether you are single or married, young or old, or somewhere in between, there is a connection group where you can find encouragement and acceptance. Pick one out and give it a try next week.
Teens in 7th through 12th grades, the Ascend Youth Conference is Wednesday through Friday, April 10th through the 12th. You will not want to miss the three-day, action-packed, memory-making event with powerful preaching, amazing games, and a trip to Knott's Berry Farms with hundreds of teens from across America. Register today at wcbcyc.com.
Just a few minutes after the conclusion of this service, you are invited to pick up your kids from childcare and bring them down to the athletic field to enjoy a giant Easter egg hunt, bounce houses, and refreshments.
If you're a guest with us today, welcome. We have a gift specifically for you that you may have already received on the way in, but if you did not receive it yet, we invite you to stop by one of the tables in the lobbies where you can pick up your gift bag. Inside is a devotional book from our pastor.
Thanks for joining us. Remember, next weekend, we return to our normal service schedule each Sunday at 8:15 or 10:45. As always, you can find out details about everything going on at Lancaster Baptist on our mobile app or our website, lancasterbaptist.org. You can also follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter.
Let's all stand together. And as you're standing, would you join me in thanking our choir and orchestra for the wonderful presentation today? Just a few reminders before you're dismissed. We've got some lovely family photo backdrops that are Easter themed right outside of our west wing. We've got the fun on the field prepared. It's shaping up to be a beautiful day. There's no wind outside right now. We don't know if that'll be true in a few hours, but take advantage of that. And thanks again for being with us. If you are a visitor, we'd love to connect with you. If this is your first time guest out in our west wing, have a great day. You're dismissed. Happy resurrection.